Appreciate you coming this afternoon. It's always humbled after a nice lunch and such a beautiful day outside that you'd actually lower yourself to come inside into an environment like this and hear somebody talk. One of the first things I want to do, though, is give you a little bit of background on how I'm going to be coming at this. I'm not a futurist. I don't get paid to guess what the future is. I'm not a commercial product company. I don't have products to sell. I'm coming from a research and development perspective, and so one of the things I want to try to do is sort of level the field and what is the state of the practices on autonomous vehicles. Now, first question I often get is it an autonomous vehicle? Is it an automated vehicle? Is it a driverless vehicle? Is it an unmanned vehicle? It's whatever you want to call it. Consensus is moving towards automated vehicle. It's sort of the consensus terminology that's coming up. But let's get in here. First of all, when people talk about automated vehicles, how many people in here like to drive? Okay, I've got a sports car, 400 horsepower, 6 on the floor, and I turn my phone off in the car. I'm not distracted at all. I enjoy seeing how fast I can go and not getting caught by the police and not wrecking my car. I have, personally, zero interest in an automated vehicle. Okay? Now, if you're a millennial, not everybody raised their hand in there, and I'm not going to ask which generation you are because that starts putting stigmas on your neighbor here, but millennials are more interested in doing something other than driving the car. I have four daughters, and my daughters have zero interest in driving. They want to text, they want to Facebook, they want Instagram, or they want to drink coffee or something else, okay, when they're in their car. They're not interested in driving, so they're a good candidate for automated cars. But I think one of the things we have to answer as a society is why all the hype on automated vehicles? What are we trying to do? And as transportation people, there's obviously different reasons that we would do something like this. Driver distraction, are you going to make the roads safer? Are you going to better utilize our existing capacity? And one of the things I encourage you as you enter the dialogue about why automated vehicles is listen carefully to who's talking. Are the car companies talking? Or is it talking heads, or is it marketing companies, or it's search engine people, et cetera? Because there's a lot of difference of opinion of why we'd want to do automated vehicles. Then there's a big question of how long do you want your vehicle to be automated? How many people in here have heard the proclamation that we're going to have driverless cars by 2017? Okay, 25% of you had. That's Google's position, okay? And you're going to hear me bash Google a little bit. It's kind of a popular thing to do, and I'm certainly on the bandwagon for it. Better than maybe your own organization. But the issue is, do you want your car to help you for 5 seconds at a time? How long does it take you to send a text? I type slow, so if it could do 30 seconds if I really need to answer an email or something like that. Do I really want my car to take me to grandma's car, or do I want to take grandma to bingo or something like that? Do I need it to drive for 2 and 3 hours? And we'll explore some of that as we go along. Next thing I want to set straight, and this is something that Steve Schlatt over from University of California Path and I strongly agree on. We have a number of disagreements. But first of all, to understanding is Google did not invent the driverless car, okay? Driverless cars started back in the 1930s. GM had operational driverless cars in 1950, one of them, okay? They actually had on show in the ITS World Congress in there. But the bottom line is people have been trying to automate driving for a long time. USDOD invests money, Google started. Anybody know what the Google efforts came from? Is after the Urban Challenge in 2007, which Carnegie Mellon won the competition, Chris Urmson was the lead of their program, and he transitioned out to California. Sebastian Thrun from Stanford was the number two team, and he transitioned down into the Google environment. So Google has been spending a lot of money in this area and has made some great progress. And probably the biggest benefit I think they've given the industry is they've given a public awareness. You know, my mother-in-law thinks that she's going to have a driverless car before she dies. She's 82. I don't have the heart to tell her it's not going to happen. Number one, she can't afford it. Number two, the technology is not there, and I don't think she's going to live that long. I told you I was going to be honest, Carol. Okay, it's after lunch. We've got to keep people a little alive here. NHTSA, most of you probably are familiar who NHTSA is. NHTSA has defined four levels of automation, and I'm going to segue to the next chart because it's actually a little more insightful. Is Society of Automobile Engineers have actually defined, I think, a little clearer, a little better model that comes up to five levels, and I don't pretend that you can read this, but the bottom line is we talk about up here, vehicle has no automation, then increasing levels of automation, and the important thing from this slide is that semi-autonomous or semi-automated is available today. if you can afford an expensive enough car, typically it's a car who's got a base price of $40,000 or $50,000 with a $10,000 technology package on it, you can get a vehicle that'll keep you bumped into the lane, it can help you with some braking assist, it can help you with adaptive cruise control, etc. Those technologies are readily available today, okay? But the key behind all those technologies, who's in charge of the vehicle? The driver. You're still, you know, even though you've got a lane keeping assist system, where are your hands supposed to be? Supposed to be on the steering wheel, nowhere else in the car. Okay, where's your foot supposed to be? Supposed to be by the accelerator and the brake. The semi-autonomous technologies, you still have a driver clearly in charge of the vehicle. The gray area becomes, as you start segueing down here into 4 and 5, is whether or not you need to have a driver in the vehicle. In fact, there's an issue of, do you need to have a steering wheel in the vehicle? And I'll talk a little bit about that as we go forward. Now, I think this is an important chart, and I will apologize that there are missing companies on here. I don't know who they are. If you tell me, I will add them, okay? I've tried to put a compendium together of who is building autonomous vehicles, because again, so many people think it's one company doing this. And by the way, I drink a lot of caffeine, so my pointer will bounce a little bit here. The point is look at the number of companies, look at the number of European companies, and there's no relativity here between the amount of money being spent on this, but it does show you there's a lot of people working in this space. A lot of companies are looking at it because a lot of people understand there's a lot of money in this area. Okay, so I want to talk about state of the practice. What are some actual examples of autonomy and what's out there? I'm going to talk about some commercial efforts. I'm not going to try to hit everybody that's doing something, so if I insult you by not putting your favorite car company on there, I apologize. I want to talk about the military space and want to talk then about some of the long-term success of this. One thing I do want to point out is there's actually work being done in the state of Texas. You know, one of the things that's always true about the TxDOT short course, there's a lot of pride in this state. And you know, the state of Texas does have different people working in this.
For keeping the cars and other people safe while on the road, and for providing feedback on how they perform in the real world. A big part of our job is to go out into the world and uncover all the potential scenarios.
My intent was not to have videos. I really apologize. Here's some video of the Google vehicle. Most of you have probably seen this or you've heard about it. The idea here is this is a computer generation model of what's going on. You can start to see how a computer sees something in 3D space and some more down here. The Google effort is something, again, that they've driven over 1 million miles of highway at this point, and it works well. Now, the one thing they tend to do, and this is true of most people, if you ever see a video of an autonomous vehicle, what's the color of the sky? It's blue. Is there any moisture on the ground? No. Are there any clouds? Maybe a couple of nice white puffy ones. The point is, it works really well in blue sky, good weather environments. You don't see videos of autonomous vehicles running through northern Minnesota in February. Okay? Now, have we done some testing in that? Sure. Okay, but let's be real about this. Currently, the Google vehicle focuses on freeway operations, and they're currently adding arterial capability. Okay, you know, the reality, if you're really going to have driverless vehicles, you have to be able to negotiate traffic signals in neighborhoods, kids on bicycles, balls going out in the road, etc. There are some cons also of the Google car. Anybody know how much hardware is on it? They use a Prius platform, and they use a Lexus, it's the RX series, a nice little cool looking SUV. It's about $125,000 of hardware if you get a discount on it, okay? So you take your base platform, and if you want an autonomous vehicle or an automated vehicle, give them another $125,000, and now you got the hardware to do it. How many people in here can spend that on a car? Just Ed Seymour, is that the only one? The other issue behind the Google vehicle, and this is an issue when I talk about some of the military stuff, is they require a high-precision digital map, which we are familiar with, but you have to pre-drive the route. So they have to pre-drive the route, picking up sensor data. They make a 3D model of the world, so then they can, when they traverse it again, they use that model moving forward. Currently, by Google's admission, they've only mapped 3,200 kilometers of the over 6 million kilometers of the U.S. Is it going to be available in 2017? First question I ask is, how big is the hard disk going to be to hold all that? I assume they're going to have a little trailer full of hard disk carrying your database for the entire country as you move around. Now, here's an area that I think has a little more reality to be seen in most of our lifetimes. They're called PEVs or different type of variants. First of all, most of you, since you're TxDOT, if you have a golf cart, do you have to license that to drive it? Who can drive a golf cart? Anybody. There's no rules. Can you drive a golf cart down Interstate 35? No. Can you drive it on a residential road? Yeah, that one, it kind of depends. You know, if there's like a golf cart crossing, you know, for a golf course, you can do it. The point is, if you start looking at residential retirement communities in those type areas, maybe closed type environments, this is a market that Google's going after that's probably very real. They're going to have 100 prototypes of these, and they're going to start testing, they said, in the summer of this year. There hasn't been much video out about it. And be available for purchase. That's Chris Urmson, by the way. Be available by 2020. Now, one of the little interesting things about this is this vehicle was designed to have no steering wheel and no accelerator brake. Now, they wanted to start testing this in California, and guess what the California law required them to do? They had to go back and add in a steering wheel, and they had to add in a brake and accelerator. Because even though California has the most progressive laws to support automated driving, they still require the ability for a human to take over control of the vehicle at any point in time. Okay? So, again, cool technology, very potential up there. Lots of companies working on this. There's three or four other companies I'm personally aware of that are trying to penetrate this market. One of them might be working in Texas. Can't tell you who. Might be within 100 miles of you if you go west. So, other commercial companies. Mercedes, most of you have seen the Mercedes driving car. Volvo, this is called their texting machine. Again, these are very real world. They work in somewhat contrived environments. Again, look at the background environment. This isn't 35 going through Austin during rush hour when they're shooting these demos. You'll notice the Europeans tend to do a little more arterial type work, but very real things that are out there. These are systems you can purchase today. They'll give you 30 seconds of automated driving, a minute of automated driving. Again, if you have the money, you can buy some things that are fairly interesting in what they do. But law in all 50 states still requires somebody to be sitting in the driver's seat. If you ever want to do something interesting, go to YouTube and search for disregard of autonomous vehicles. And it shows you how people have gamed the system, and they start the autonomous vehicle up and they jump in the back seat. It's kind of interesting. I don't think I should show those videos. Here's another couple areas that has a tremendous use of autonomy today. John Deere has an automated tractor. Now, you think about doing a field and all the operations, it's perfect things for having a driverless type tractor. Why? Because it's a very constrained environment. The rows are the same. Every time you go through, you can very easily program the tractor to go do its operations. Do you have kids playing in the field? Typically not. You don't have ball. Do you have teenage drivers traversing in front of you trying to cut you off? No, you don't. You're dealing in an environment where you have a single vehicle that's got an operation in a defined space that shouldn't have other vehicles in it. Works very well. That's very real technology. It's available today. If you have it, you can go out and buy it. It's not hugely expensive because they don't put a lot of fancy sensors on it because they're not trying to interpret traffic signals or signs or that type of thing. They're taking pre-programmed routes through fields that requires a much smaller sensor set. So all of a sudden, you take a $500,000 tractor and you add $50,000 of hardware, it can do this type of operation. Another one, if you've been watching the video over here, is Komatsu. They're a Japanese company. That truck, the tire is 12 feet tall. This is pictures from an open pit mine down in Australia. And they have those monster trucks going down 24 hours a day into the mine and up the mine. That's all they do. They go down, they get a load, and they come up. There's no driver on it. Now, one of the things that's interesting about this is the dusty environment. One of the holy grails in automated vehicles is dust storms. Anybody here ever come from West Texas? I grew up in Midland, okay? You put a LiDAR like Google has in a dust storm and it thinks there's a million cars coming at you because every sand particle starts looking like a car. Not a good situation. But how they're successful is these roads have no other vehicles. So if something gets in front of, if a boulder comes down or somebody walks down, the truck simply stops. And then someone has to climb up the stairs and hit restart to get it to go moving again. But from a controlled environment, constrained environment, it works really well. TxDOT's actually done some work in automated vehicles, if you're not aware of it. John Barton had a concept of, could you automate the attenuator truck so that when you're doing a road convoy, you don't put someone in the risk of actually being the driver's seat of the vehicle. So we actually took an autonomous vehicle and put a maybe kind of a cheesy attenuator on the back. It looked like a big ice chest, if you will. But the idea behind it is, could you interact with people? And then the other thing we implemented was hand signals so that you could actually control the autonomous vehicles. Again, you're starting to get into that kind of constrained space where a work zone, you have a little less issues. And the preliminary work that was done said, yeah, you know, technology may be ready for this type of thing. And it's something that the industry is starting to look at. But it's really neat to see TxDOT on the forefront of trying to say, how can we use automation to improve worker safety in work zone type environments? This is an interesting slide. A lot of people know that the military pushes research and development. They help us move things along in the industry. Here's a slide from U.S. Army TARDEC. TARDEC is the R&D center for the U.S. Army, because who has the most vehicles in the DOD? The Army, right? Yes, I know that the Navy has some and the Air Force has some, but the Army is what we're going to focus on for the next couple minutes. So their idea is they start talking about how you're going to remote control these things. And one of the things that's really important, the only thing I really need you to read, is they talk about autonomous and collaborative autonomous. And you'll notice there's no dates on this. You know, the Army's smart enough not to put a date in there. The Army was actually given a mandate in 2001 to have 1/3 of the ground fleet of the U.S. Army automated by 2015. By a show of hands, how many people think they've achieved that? How many vehicles have been automated in the Army? This is a congressional mandate. They have 340,000 vehicles, so do the math. They had to automate 125,000 by next year. Anybody want to guess where they're at? Zero. Okay? And I think they have about the biggest unlimited budget available. In other words, R&D is showing that they're not quite ready yet. Now, they made some good progress, and I want to talk about it. But again, the point is the military is not ready to use automated vehicles. Now, one of the things that's interesting, we actually do a lot of work in the military space. It's one thing to go down Interstate 35. It's another thing to go down to our arterial. But they have some interesting problems that they face. It's kind of fun to see the type of bridges they cross. That doesn't mean you don't cross the bridge. It just means you need to slow down because there's a bump in the middle of the bridge. But you still have to get your vehicle. They do have a little bit of mud every once in a while. That one obviously is not getting out of there. There's not enough wheels in the ground, and they have to go through water and stuff like that. Again, very different types of problems. Off-road autonomy is very different than on-road autonomy, but they're still trying to solve some of those problems. One of the things that the military understood early on is that most people can't afford, you know, if a fully autonomous car became available tomorrow, would you sell your current car? What happened if you drive a 63 Corvette to work? Do you really want an autonomous Corvette? You know, think about that from a legislative perspective. Somebody has said, well, what that needs to happen is Congress needs to come in and says you can have no manned vehicles in 20 years. Okay? How many people would vote for that? I mean, you know, even if they were no cost differential, I mean, because you have people like myself who drive. You know, if you have an old Corvette or an old Mustang, it would be like heresy to automate that, right? I mean, you would never automate a vehicle like that. So there's some challenges. So what the military said is, okay, how can we solve this? So they came up with this idea, and you'll hear about this as you continue to learn about the industry, something called an A-Kit. And the A-Kit is like the brains. It's the computer, it's the sensors, and the idea is that you can take an A-Kit, it's in a box, and you can plug it in one vehicle, and when that vehicle gets destroyed, you unplug the A-Kit, and you walk over and you plug it into another vehicle. Because what they're trying to do is say, let's take our investment in the brains and the computers and all that and make it portable between vehicles, because the reality in a military environment is, one, vehicles don't always start every day, okay? And if you're in a hostile environment, you don't have a bunch of mechanics out there to fix it, so you need to change to another vehicle. Well, the A-Kit cooperates with something called a B-Kit, which is the hardware interface that ties into the automated driving, braking, shifting, etc. And so the concept is your hardware, your vehicle would be equipped for autonomy with a B-Kit, and then you can come plug your A-Kit on. That way, if there's upgrades that come out, you simply upgrade your A-Kit, you upgrade the brains of it. And this is the concept that the DOD is trying to push as they move forward. So let's talk about some examples of DOD programs. You know, I think one of the best ways to understand the technology is say, what are people doing out there? Here's one called GUS. GUS is it's an unmanned support system. It's a mule, if you will. And I don't know how many of you know people in the military, but if you know an infantryman or you know a guy who's on the ground, they carry a lot of weight. I mean, what's a Marine carry? Marine carries, what's three primary things a Marine needs? Ammo, a gun, chow, and water, okay? Now, one of the things they've learned is if you take a Marine's pack and you find a way to make something lighter, what does the Marine do? There's got to be some Marines in here. You add more ammo. Okay? I mean, if you say, okay, my pack weighed 110, if you find a way to make my pack weigh 105, I'm going to put on 5 more pounds of ammo. Because, I mean, if you're out there, that's what's going to save your life is having more ammo. So this is an example of trying to say, how can you automate and how can you get a surrogate to potentially help ferry supplies up? How do you get wounded soldiers back, et cetera? Because, again, another challenge is, you know, if you're a Marine, you don't want to leave your fallen comrade. You know, if you got a guy who's injured, and let's say you're in a squad of 7 people, Somebody goes down, and let's say it takes two people to drag. Now you're down to four operational Marines. Can you potentially use automation to put your wounded buddy on, get the warfighter on the platform, let the platform go back, and keep your two guys still in combat that are active? And that's what some of the thinking is going, but you can see some of the type of technology that they're using. Now, I love this video, okay? Because if you think about Afghanistan and Iraq, one of the challenges is supplies. How do you get stuff out there? So this is an example of an autonomous helicopter. This is not a drone, okay? Now, because how are drones flown? I mean, I think most people know there's pilots in Nevada or somewhere that are using joysticks and they're driving drones, okay? This is a fully autonomous platform. It's been pre-programmed with the plan. There's not somebody sitting there with a joystick and pedals controlling this vehicle. This vehicle is truly autonomous without an operator on the ground running it. Now, I will admit, yes, there is a kill switch and they can rescue it, but it's not part of the the missions that you're seeing here are not being flown by humans on a joystick from 10,000 miles away. It's being driven by the computer on board the helicopter. Now, there was a lot of suspicion about whether or not this would work, and so they took it out to Afghanistan, and it flew its first mission in 2011. It's still being used. It tells you something. Now, what's the downside of this autonomy? Well, if you know much about weights and everything, it can't deliver very much cargo, okay? And so now they're trying to figure out how do we get bigger platforms and how do you start having competing helicopters. The other thing, helicopters tend to announce themselves by noise before they get it, you know, before they get close, which in some environments is not something that's practical. But again, interesting use of an automated vehicle. Another program, this was done by Lockheed Martin, and this is this A kit and B kit I talked about. These are obviously large trucks. These are 20-ton trucks, and these are all running autonomously. Those will be some close-ups here in a minute, but this is suggesting to do convoy operations. Approximately half of the wounded troops that we get are from convoy operations, from IEDs type activities, and so convoys are a tough place to have vehicles. And so the idea is, how can we make those driverless? You know, maybe have one with a driver. Wouldn't it be cool if the driver wasn't in the front vehicle? Maybe put the driver in the rear vehicle and he's basically pushing the convoy as they move along the road. So there's been a lot of work done on this, and as you watch this video, you can see the type of corners they're doing. You know, you can't do Grand Prix type driving. You know, you're not going to be, drafting a foot and a half behind somebody and cutting corners to the nearest millimeter because there's accuracy issues. But you can see the type of roads that they can go down. And it's somewhat they're not driving in the right-hand edge for a reason. There's technical reasons why you can't do that. And so you'll notice on these, you never see a passing convoy in any of these videos. You never see two convoys coming like this. You've never seen that video done yet. And again, there's some reasons for that we probably don't need to delve into. But again, pretty cool type applications of autonomy in a military environment. Here's another another small support type thing. Notice these are packs on here, and the idea is sometimes you'll see the device actually running in front of the crew, in front of the squad. Sometimes it'll be behind. Idea behind this is it's hauling materials for you. It's a rugged device. This is running autonomous. This is not being teleopt. It doesn't have a remote control of it. This is actually, you know, the onboard computer is deciding what to do on this. One of the things you may have seen on that, if you look in the front, you see that little spinning, see those spinning things? Those are called LIDAR. They're made by a company called Velodyne. This demonstration this one is in Hawaii, I believe. It's never been in theater. Anybody know why? If you have a vehicle with a spinning laser on it, what would that be to an enemy? A target. Very good. I like this audience. Because the enemy would learn what shoot 2 feet below the spinning laser, right? And you'll probably take out the engine or do something like that. So one of the challenges the military has is they can't use active sensor technology because active sensor technology tells the bad guys where you're at, okay? So one more example, just because this is cool big trucks. Oshkosh, if you're familiar with them in the military things, they make even bigger trucks. If you like trucks as a kid, you know, you played with trucks when you were 6 years old, you got to love an Oshkosh trucks. They're huge. And they're doing the same thing that Lockheed Martin did, making these things autonomous. You can see here, you can see this is the technology up here. It's using, notice those cars weren't moving, going down through some barrels. Again, you see there's no drivers in here. This type of concept is you put a driver back here and you push the mine roller truck, because if the mine roller truck hits an IED, you lose a $300,000 truck, but you don't lose a warfighter. And so that's what the technologies they're trying to develop as they move forward. Again, pretty cool use of technology. So the Marine Corps, who maybe are a little more realistic than what the Army's been doing, because again, if you think of a convoy operation, if you have a convoy with a bunch of active targets, and then insurgents have, you know, shoulder-mounted type devices, you still have the problem with active sensors. So the Marines then challenged a couple companies to come up with a camera-only, in other words, a passive-only technology that allow them to move their vehicle through theater environments. And then they said, oh, by the way, you can't have GPS either, because GPS, my kids think GPS is an inalienable right, like it's in the Constitution. You know, if you think of the era of smart bombs, how do smart weapons work, smart bombs? You know, the initial versions use GPS to help triangulize in and figure out how to get in your enemy. So what does the enemy do? And what do in our forces? We have GPS jammers, okay? You can go on eBay. I didn't look last night. I normally look the night before my presentation, but for about $1,000, you can buy a highly illegal GPS jammer. We could set it right here, and you all would think we're sitting at CTR in Austin rather than in Texas A&M if we set the coordinates right. Every one of your iPhones would show you were sitting in Austin, okay? So the military can't rely on having a GPS. So here's a program that they did. It had various performers. This video is actually from San Antonio. We were one of the companies involved in this. And this vehicle has no GPS enabled on it, and it has no map, and it was simply told to go to the other end of the field. Now, how many people read Family Circus cartoon? One of my favorite cartoons. Remember Billy? Does Billy ever go home in a straight line? Billy's very serpentine in how he gets places. That's what you're going to see in this vehicle, is this vehicle is feeling its way through the environment right now. It's actually looking for what is the easiest thing to drive on. And it's looking for gravel or concrete, number one. So let's drive along through this grass. And by the way, if you put the Google car in here, what would happen to the Google car? Dead stop, because you can't have grass 2 feet tall in front of a LiDAR, because a LiDAR sees every one of those as an object. Very hard to resolve with LiDAR only. So you'll see here, now the vehicle slides over and says, hey, I see some concrete. So again, it's just working its way down the other end of the field. Never takes the same path twice, so that's when you see the video, you'll notice it doesn't look like the grass has been beat down, because we never know which way it's going to go. So we simply put a chase vehicle and say, follow it, and try to take some videos as it moves along. Now, how it does this is it uses an array of 14 cameras, has 8 cameras up front with a stereo pair, and uses a technology called multispectral analysis, which can determine, is it grass, is it gravel, is it tree bark, leaves, and different type of things. And in a minute, you're going to see how the computer actually sees it. So in this case, it's driving, there's a kind of a primitive road there. It comes up, and it's trying to decide, can I drive through? Because one of the questions it says to itself is, oh, well, if that's a tree, I can run it over. Now, this is where technology point becomes, this is, by the way, how the computer's looking at the world. That's the live video out on the left. The right is how the computer's making decisions and where to drive. If you're in a military environment, collateral damage is acceptable, okay? In the military, if you run over your neighbor's mailbox, what are they going to do about it? If you're in Afghanistan, nothing. Now, if you're in your neighborhood and you run over your neighbor's mailbox, what's going to happen? You're probably going to get a $500,000 lawsuit on pain and suffering because you took out their favorite mailbox that had their best insignia that their kid drew on or something like that. The point is that if you can accept some potential damage, automated vehicles are ready today, okay? If you have to have them perfect or near perfect, they're a ways away. Now, here's another example I want to talk about. This is a very different type of autonomous vehicle platform. This is plastic. The only metal on here are these tubes. Everything else is plastic. It's actually, if you have $35,000, you can buy one in a government contract. These are available from a GSA schedule online to buy them. These vehicles, if you've ever ridden in one, 85 miles an hour top speed. They're a hoot to drive. And what is happening is that for the Army, Special Forces never drive down the roads. So they said, we want a vehicle that we can drive manually and get close to where we want to do something, then we're going to get out, and we want the vehicle to support our operation. Maybe it's with a payload, with a surveillance payload in the back, or they're going to walk in a half a mile, do something mean to somebody, and then they need to get out of there really quick, and they can whistle the vehicle up. So this vehicle was developed. It's actually, again, down in San Antonio, and we've developed the same platform using Jeep Rubicons and these type of devices. Here's a picture of it going over to Afghanistan. This vehicle spent 6 months in two vehicles spent 6 months in Afghanistan between February and July, and I guess the best report is they both came home, and they rolled off the plane. They didn't have to be carried off the plane, so the technology came home. But this shows you some of the different type of operations. One of the things that the military wants in all of these is they want the ability to teleop. It's an interesting requirement. You know, the commercial industry has no interest in this. The military, a firm requirement is there's a joystick somewhere where I can control the vehicle. Now, in this particular mode, now this vehicle is going back to this camera technology. You see the array of cameras on top, and it's going through, and if it sees an object, it will plan around it or it'll stop. It won't run it over. Again, a little bit like Billy on the circus. Now, here's something you don't see a lot of people doing. Let's do this in reverse, okay? I mean, most of the examples of autonomy are going forward. You kind of wonder, well, military should never go backwards. Well, that's true, but sometimes you need to get a vehicle out of a place where maybe it shouldn't have been going forward. This is kind of an interesting thing. Is in this particular mode, what we're saying is, now, follow the soldier. And so it kind of follows like your loyal puppy dog. It's not a perfect follow. If you watch where he's going, you say, you know, if you were manually driving, you'd probably be centered in those two lanes. But the vehicle is basically following along. And then let's say your soldier's going up here and he says, you know, follow me here at 15 meters. And then at some point, the soldier may go, you know, that looks suspicious up there and I don't want to step on it. And then we're going to get into a mode where we actually push the vehicle so you can walk behind the vehicle. And then when you turn, the vehicle turns. Now, obviously, it's a little contrived how you do that because if you think of your distance behind it. But this video kind of goes on and on, so I'm not going to belabor this because I want to make sure we get through our talk on time. But it's a pretty interesting technology. So here's two vehicles that actually went out to Afghanistan and came back with positive results. Here's another program where this is the A-kit we talk about. We put the system together for Marines, and then the Swiss from Switzerland, their Ministry of Defense said, would this work on a Swiss vehicle we have? So this is an autonomous vehicle in Switzerland. You can tell it was a very different architecture. It's a European-type architectured vehicle. So we brought over an A-kit, which is essentially U.S. military A-kit, dropped it on top of it, and they gave us 24 hours to test before they said we're going to go out and do an operational test. So the first day we tested, it was great. Then it snowed overnight. Now, we're from South Texas. Okay, I've seen snow 15 years ago in San Antonio. It doesn't snow much down there. So we said, I wonder how our system's going to work in the snow. And the more interesting part in the video is going to come up in just a minute, but you can see this is going autonomously through forest roads, same type of maps that you saw before. Here's the standard camera vision. This is how the computer is interpreting, and what it's saying is try to drive where it's brown. That's the safest place to drive. There's a picture of the hardware on front. And then they said, well, we're going to go to some back roads. We thought, oh, that's pretty cool. Then they showed up on this road, and they said, well, here, we just want to drive down this road. Now, we still to this day don't really know why this worked. But it didn't roll off the cliff. And what this vehicle was doing is essentially coming through here and saying, well, this is still the safest place to drive. So again, you can see down here, it's following those red marks. If it had been totally snow covered, the vehicle wouldn't have worked. But it was an interesting demonstration of taking some technology to a different space. So people always still ask me, where do you see autonomy? I told you up front it wasn't a futurist. You know, a futurist is some guy who makes a ridiculous amount of money predicting the future. I never understand why people want to pay someone $10,000 and Carol didn't pay me anything to come. you know, why people want to listen to that sometime. But, you know, you still get asked the question, is it going to be out there? There is a lot of press out there. My position is that if you have a constrained environment and you can accept a few casualties every once in a while, and I don't mean to sound gruesome with that, but in a military environment, if you drive over somebody, as bad as that is a fact of war, okay? And that's a fact of a hostile environment. And so they have a different set of credentials that we're going to get out of our normal state government. And what you'll notice on these is all of them can accept some of that damage. And, you know, people keep telling us, oh, they're going to be available in the next couple of years. Well, this is a fascinating study that I think is really important to see. And some of you in this room are probably were here. There was something called the Automated Vehicle Summit held in California in July of 2014. They had 500 people that were supposed to be really smart. They all worked in the industry. You know, people that worked in R&D companies, from military organizations, from GM, from Google, from, you know, all the different ones. And so it's interesting to look at, they had a survey and 250 people responded. And first of all, these are fairly educated people. Then the more interesting thing was they were engineers, okay? So I think we have engineers hopefully have a little bit of credibility in this room as we move forward. The interesting thing was is that 80% of them were in the United States, and of the respondents, most were in California and Michigan. So these were car people who were answering these questions. And they gave some interesting results. First thing is the top three barriers they said to automated vehicles are legal, regulation, and cost. Notice the word technology doesn't appear up there. Kind of interesting. Now, is the technology ready? No. But we don't, the engineers didn't think that was the most big, the biggest problem that was out there. So of the people, about half the people said, you know, technology's there, and the other half said they didn't. I think this is interesting, is 56% of the people thought that automated vehicles would be as safe or two times safer. And so one of the things I ask you, is that a compelling reason to do autonomy? Is that enough of a mandate? You know, that's not as big increase as I would have thought. But again, these are engineers who are guessing this as they go along. This is an interesting number, because I always ask this, will society accept the machines crashing into each other? So a decent portion there. Remember, level three is a semi-autonomous type perspective. And, you know, engineers are still kind of lukewarm. Okay, some of that is you don't see a lot of U.S.-based automated. The semi-automated systems I talked about are primarily from Europe and from Asia. There's not a lot of U.S. semi-automated. Yes, GM made the announcement that they're going to have Super Cruise available, but that's still a couple years out before that's going to be in the production line. And the other thing that I think is fascinating, and Brian's going to talk about in a few moments from the U.S. DOT perspective, is two-thirds of the people said if you don't have vehicle-to-vehicle communication, don't even try to do automated work. And I agree with that in spades. It's a very true comment. That's an important technology component. But this is my favorite question. I think this is always kind of a great way to try to wrap up your feelings on this. They said, you know, most of the time what you hear is if you hear a commercial, you see one of these things, they're talking about taking Carol's kid to school. They said, no, take your kid to school, not someone else's kid. Take your kid or your grandma, and would you put them in a car with no driver to take them to school? And when will that occur? And again, remember, these are engineers who build the technology. These aren't marketing people. And I love the data. 25% of the people said, no, I would never do that. A vast majority said 2030 through 2040. When you hear the hype before, you know, when all these people keep saying 2017, basically what this data tells you is that none of the engineers who build this believe it's going to occur in the next 15 years. So when we talk about automated vehicles, we probably ought to have a take a deep breath. I don't think I'm going to see it in my professional career. I don't know if I'll see it in my lifetime or not. But my guess is my kids may see some of this in their lifetime. Last major issue on this, they've done some very interesting polls out there. Now, how many people have ever heard the term safety does not sell in the car business? What sells? If you're buying it, if you just graduated from Texas A&M, you're 22 years old, and you buy a car, what will a kid spend their money on? Stereo. You can get $1,000 out of any kid to put a bigger stereo in their car. You tell them, hey, you can get ESC. They don't tell them it's electronic stability control, and they're like, I don't want that option. I want the bigger woofer, man. So they did a poll, and the bottom line is that people have said that they'll pay about $3,000 for autonomy. Now, as Carol said, we built 8 different autonomous cars. The cheapest computer we have on any one of our vehicles is $12,000. Okay? That's the cheapest amount of computing power. I'm not talking about any sensor. I'm talking just the computing power on the vehicle alone. You go into Moore's Law and how, you know, computer power is supposed to change every 18 months, which has kind of died off. We're still not hitting Moore's Law as much anymore, especially in computerized, rugged vehicles. The point is that the cost of driverless or automated driving is still over $100,000 no matter which platform you use. And so unless you have really expensive platforms or really expensive cargo, automated vehicles are probably going to be a ways away. Now, this is one of my favorite slides because I get into a battle, particularly with some University of Texas professors about this. I asked them a question. I said, okay, now those of you in the panhandle, if it's snowing and there's a deer in front of you, what do? You hit the deer, right? I mean, that's how I taught my kids. Now, if there's a human in front of you, what do? You try to miss it, okay? So now you're trying to build what into your car? A conscious. Now, it's hard enough to build a conscious into a kid, okay? Now I'm trying to program a conscious into a vehicle. So I have this photo that I love, and I ask, but the people from the university said, deers are easy. I can always tell my car the deer because it's got such a neat profile. So I ask, what is that? I'll give you an option. It's either an incredibly ugly kid with big ears, or it's a deer. Now, what's the computer say it is? The computer says it's a human being. Why? Because how many legs do you see? I mean, you got to understand, computers at 80 meters, size of pixels, it's going to say 2 legs, got a body, got a head, got ears. My computer's going to say that's a car. Okay, strike up some more caffeine. The computer's going to say that's a human being. Avoid it. Okay? So think about it. You got black ice, you got snow. What does your car do? It goes into an emergency stop. It tries to get off the road. It rolls over and it kills you. And why'd you do it? Because your computer thought that deer was a kid. Okay? So my point is that for someone who makes a living writing software for the last 35 years, that's a serious problem. Another really cool problem I like to talk about, I was in D.C. I don't know if some other folks that live in U.S. That live in D.C., but this was during the Uber craze in D.C. And all the taxi drivers decided to have a strike one afternoon, and they said, we're going to drive around the Capitol building and all the legislative buildings, and they basically ignored traffic signals. So this is actually a picture from the paper. These are all cabs, and they were driving around. On the same day, Chairman Schuster from Pennsylvania was in the vehicle from Carnegie Mellon, who was on Washington, D.C., to give senators rides. And guess what happened to the automated vehicle when this occurred? It tried to pull into the traffic. And anybody know how long it sat there? According to someone from Carnegie Mellon, it sat there for 31 minutes before it pulled in because the vehicle didn't know how to nose in to traffic. So again, think about driving patterns that you have, the good ones and the bad ones, and the successful ones, and maybe the not so successful ones. But how do you then build in aggression into a computer? So in other words, you can handle the tensor driving conditions. You know, do you have to have that? Now, if you had vehicle-to-vehicle comms and you could stop cars, there's ways to do that. The point is, there's a lot of challenges out there. So what do I see? In the next 3 to 20 years, we're gonna see lots of level 3, level 4 autonomy, lots of cool things to help you stay in your lane, help you auto-brake, keep from hitting people, V2V, V2I type things, the vehicle-to-vehicle communications, vehicle-to-infrastructure, and make your cars get safer. Game-changing, we think things like ports, retirement communities are probably where you'll see this things first. You're not going to see it on the interstates right away. You're not going to see it in arterials. We strongly believe you need connected to get automated. And again, Brian's going to be talking about that in the next talk. If that doesn't make sense to you, I think it will after Brian talks. And there's really still three major holy grails, maybe four, but it didn't fit on the slide, so I made it three. Perceptions and behaviors, trying to make a computer as smart as a human. As bad as there, I mean, we all know there's a lot of bad, everyone except you all is a bad driver, okay? Well, think about programming a computer that can do that. That's a huge, huge problem. It's still not a solved problem. Cost is the issue we talked about, and I think the technology issue is very real. I think you'll see millennials or the next generation being much more open to this, but a lot of folks that have a little bit of gray hair probably really aren't interested in an automated vehicle. Maybe some are, but the statistics say they're not.